great after being out late, walking my baby back home. Arm in arm over meadow and farm, walking my baby back home. We go long harmonizing a song, or I'm reciting a poem. Hours go by and they give me the eye, walking my baby back home. We stop for a while, she gives me a smile, snuggles her head on my chest. We starting to pet, and that's when I get her talcum all over my vest. After I kinda straighten my tie, she has to borrow my comb. One kiss, then I continue again, walking my baby back home. The dark, so I have to park outside of her door till it's light. She says if I try to kiss her, she'll cry. I dry her tears all through the night, hand in hand to a barbecue stand. Right from her doorway we roam. Eats and then it's a pleasure again, walking my baby, talking my baby, loving my baby. I don't mean maybe, walking my baby back
home. Gunsmoke, brought to you by L&M Filters with the miracle tip, king size, regular, both at the same low price. Around Dodge City and in the territory on West, there's just one way to handle the killers and the spoilers, and that's with a U.S. Marshal and the smell of gun smoke. Gunsmoke, starring William Conrad. The transcribed story of the violence that moved west with young America. And the story of a man who moved with it.
I'm that man. Matt Dillon, United States Marshal. The first man they look for and the last they want to meet. It's a chancy job, and it makes a man watchful. And a little lonely.
Look in the window over there. In the restaurant, Mr. Dillon.
What?
Doc's got himself a girl.
Well, I'll be. I never saw her before, Chester.
He's waving at us. He wants us to come in.
Oh, all right. Look, you come in and say hello and then go on out of the telegraph office, huh? Might be important.
Okay, sir. That girl must be a real good friend, Mr. Dillon, if Doc's buying her dinner.
Yeah, if he is.
He better be. She ain't half ugly.
Shh. I wouldn't put it exactly that way to her.
Hello there, Matt. Chester.
Hello, Doc.
Hello, Doc. Well, Abby, this is Marshal Dillon and Chester Proudfoot. Abby Twilling.
How do you do, gentlemen?
Miss Twilling.
How do you do?
Sit down.
Well, thank you, Doc.
Well, I'll be back directly, Doc. I got to go across to the depot. There's a telegraph waiting for Mr. Dillon.
I'll be here, Chester.
Okay, sir. I'll hurry.
Doc's been telling me about you, Marshal.
Oh?
Oh, now, don't look at me like that now, man. She wants to know all about Dodge. And I've been trying to tell her what to expect.
Well, in Dodge, you can expect almost anything, Miss Twilling.
So I hear.
Had Abby seen her share of violence, Matt? She was a nurse in the war.
Oh?
Well, that's how I met Doc. We worked in the same hospital for nearly a year.
Oh, best doggone nurse I ever saw. Yeah, I'm trying to talk her into settling down here. Old Dodge could use somebody like her.
Are you moving on, Miss Twilling?
Why, I haven't any plans, Marshal. I've been working in St. Louis, but it's lonely, and I got restless and decided to ride the Santa Fe as far west as it goes. I'm on sort of a vacation, you might say.
Somebody on the train mentioned my name, and she looked me up right off.
Well, it's been a long time, Doc.
Yeah, too long. Oh, you stay here, Abby. We'll keep you busy. Oh, yes, and who knows, maybe we'll even find you a husband. Oh, my, I'm sorry.
That's all right, Doc. You see, my husband was killed in the war, Marshal, the first year. That's why I went into nursing.
Oh, I see.
Well, I think I'd better get back to the hotel.
Yeah, I'll take you, Abby. Yes, you're going to wait here for Chester, man?
Oh, he's coming now. It is a pleasure to meet you, Miss Twilling.
Thank you, Marshal. Good night.
Good night. I'll see you later, Doc.
Sure, man. This way, Abby.
Doc. Well, I got it, Mr. Dillon. Here you are.
Oh, thanks, Jesse. Sit down while I read it.
Who's it from?
Oh, it's from Wyatt Earp out in Arizona.
It is? Is he coming here?
No. No, it says, Coney Thorne released from state prison last week. I hear he's looking for you, so you better go on wearing that gun a while longer. Good luck, W. Earp.
Who's Coney Thorne, Mr. Dillon? What's he want of you?
And I expect he wants to kill me, Chester.
What? What for?
Well, I arrested him out in Arizona a long time ago. He was one of the suspects in the stage holdup. So I had to bring him in, even though I thought he had nothing to do with it.
Well, then why'd he go to prison?
Well, I wasn't on the jury, Chester. Anyway, I left that part of the country before he was tried. I heard later that he was sent to prison.
Well, you didn't have nothing to do with it.
No, I arrested him. And according to this telegram, he thinks I had a lot to do with it.
And he's really coming here, huh?
Coney Thorne wasn't a bad man, Chester. But prison may have changed him some. Yeah, he'll probably be here next week sometime.
L&M filters are sweeping the country. L&M, the filter tip cigarette everyone's talking about, everyone's changing to. Here's what John Robert Powers told us. I never realized a filter cigarette could taste this good, and at the same time, filter so much more effectively. I'm convinced this is it.
And Patricia Morrison says, I changed to L&M filters, and I'm so glad I did. Because here's a filter cigarette that really tastes the way a cigarette should.
David Wayne wrote, L&M's have the best filter of them all. Miracle Tip is right. There's nothing like it.
Yes, L&M filters are truly sweeping the country, breaking more sales records every day.
The reason? It's the filter that counts, and no filter compares with L&M's Miracle Tip. Notice how easy it draws. You get much more flavor, much less nicotine. Yes.
This is it. L&M filters, this is it, something new.
Now, two sizes.
L&M filters, new king size and regular two.
This is it.
L&M filters, L&M filters with the miracle tip.
So join the trend to L&M.
King size, regular, both at the same low price.
There were a lot of things I didn't like about being a lawman, and having to face a man who was out purely for revenge was one of them. It didn't matter what his reasons were. When Coney Thorne arrived, I had to shoot it out with him. A man who'd travel all the way to Dodge City from Arizona wasn't going to be put off by arguments. However, a week passed, and he didn't show up, and I began to hope that maybe he had changed his mind. Until one day when I was sitting with Kitty watching the crowd from the porch of the Dodge House.
Well, must be supper time. Here comes the noon stage.
The way he's driving those horses, he shouldn't be late.
He's never been on time yet unless there was an Indian scare going on. Not many passengers. Three. No, another one getting out.
Yeah.
All strangers.
No. Not all of them, Kitty. Not to me.
What?
That last man I got out. I've been waiting for him.
Coney Thorne?
Well, I might as well get this over with right now. Look, Kitty, you better go inside, huh?
Yeah, I sure will. Good luck, Matt.
Yeah.
Dylan?
What took you so long? I was expecting you last week.
How'd you know I was coming?
You must have told somebody.
You got friends everywhere, ain't you, Marshal?
I never thought you had anything to do with that holdup, Coney. I told you at the time I was sorry I had to take you in.
I've been 5 years in prison, Marshal, no matter what you thought.
I'm not apologizing. But you're free now, Coney. Why do you want to die?
What makes you think I'm going to die?
Well, a man in prison doesn't get much chance to handle a gun. You must be pretty rusty by now.
A lot of ways to kill a man, Marshal.
In the back? Think about it. Now, you've changed, Connie. You were a man once.
5 years in prison, Marshal, wasn't any good. Nearly went crazy. I would have till I got to thinking about who put me there. That saved my mind, kind of.
Yeah, but you're out now. It's all over.
Oh, not yet. I ain't gonna fight you, Marshal. Not till I'm ready. Not till I figure out how to kill you. I'm gonna make you go crazy waiting the way I've done. And I'll sleep all the better knowing you're gonna have to have one eye open every minute from now on.
You're not the first man who's wanted to kill me.
Maybe not. But I'm going to be the first to do it.
Oh, hello. Good morning,
Matt. Hello, Doc. How come you're up so early?
Well, I got a call last night, Matt, about 3 o'clock. A fellow of the Dodge House was keeping everybody awake.
Huh? Well, it sounds more like they should have called me.
No, he wasn't drunk, Matt. He was delirious. Yeah, it's brain fever, most people call it.
Oh?
Well, I couldn't leave him there alone, so I got Abby Twilling to take a room next to his.
The first chance you got, you put her to work, huh?
Well, a man that sick has to have care, Matt.
Well, you talk like he's going to die.
Not with Abby working on him. He isn't.
Well, that's fine.
Yeah, the man's name is Coney Thorne, Matt.
What?
Yeah, he won't be up and about for another week, though.
Yeah, I thought he looked sick when he got off the stage yesterday.
Well, he was.
Now, maybe it was the fever that made him talk like he was planning to shoot me in the back.
What's that?
Yeah, that wasn't like Coney. He was never that kind of a man.
Good morning, Mr. Dillon. Doc?
Oh, good morning, Chester. Oh, where'd you get that mail at this hour?
It ain't mail, Doc. It's a telegraph here, Mr. Dillon.
Yeah, you know, sometimes I wish they'd never invented the telegraph.
But maybe it's Washington, Matt, offering you a raise.
If they'd send me last month's check by mail, I'd be satisfied.
Well, what is it, Mr. Dillon?
It's from a U.S. Marshal in Phoenix. He says if Coney Thorne has left Arizona, he's broken his parole. And if he turns up here looking for me, they'll arrest him.
I didn't know he was on parole.
No, neither did I. But they're willing to pay the expense of sending him back under escort.
You going all the way to Arizona with him, Mr. Dillon?
No, of course not. I'll hire somebody.
Well, you can't put that man in jail, Matt.
Now, why not?
He's too sick. And I won't have Abby nursing a man in jail. It's bad enough in the hotel.
Well, as long as he can't run away.
He'll be in bed for a week. And if you don't tell him about this, he won't run anyway.
Okay, Doc. I'll leave him alone. For a week. I kept track of Coney's progress through Doc. And the rest of Dodge did, too. Everybody in town knew he'd come there to shoot me, and it seemed like they were all waiting for him to get well and try it. And there were a number of men who'd have been right happy if he'd done it. I waited for over a week, and he was still in bed. So finally, I went over to the hotel to have a talk with him.
Marshal Dillon.
Hello, Abby. Can we come in?
Why, of course. Come in.
Thank you.
Hello, Chester.
Hello, Miss Dillon.
Now, where's your patient?
Oh, this is my room, Marshal. He's right through there. I have it arranged this way so he won't be disturbed.
Now, is he still sick, Abby?
He's better.
Well, Doc says that he could get up.
Please, Marshal. Give him a little more time, a couple of days. It's very important.
It is?
I know what he came here for. It doesn't matter to you if he stays in bed a while longer, does it?
No, but if he's well, why are you keeping him in bed?
It's good for him. Coney needs a rest like this. You've no idea how much he needs it. Please, Marshal.
Abby.
Yes?
You've got to know Coney pretty well, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
What kind of a man would you say he is?
He's a good man, Marshal. But he's suffered a lot being in prison the way he was. And, well, it's like soldiers I've seen who've been through too much. They change for a while, anyway. But if they're given a chance, the right kind of a chance, they find their way back sometimes.
That's what you're doing, giving him a chance, huh?
I'm trying, Marshal.
Well, how does he feel about it?
I'm not sure yet.
Chester.
Yes, sir?
I changed my mind about talking to Coney. Come on.
Okay.
Thank you, Marshal.
I guess I'll know how you make out, Abby, one way or the other.
I swear I don't understand what he was talking about, Mr. Dillon.
Well, I don't understand it either, Chester, but... My guess is that Abby's fallen in love with him.
What? that don't make sense.
That seldom does. That doesn't keep it from happening.
No, sir. My, kind of scary, ain't it?
Well, Abby's a little scared. She's not sure about Coney. But anyway, he trusts her enough to have told her about being out on parole. That's why she figured I'd heard about it and had come to arrest him.
What you gonna do?
Well, Abby asked for a couple of more days, Chester. I think she deserves them. Evening, Kitty. I just coming in to say hello.
Well, the air's better out here, Matt. I never saw that saloon so crowded as it is tonight.
Oh, a couple of new herds arrived today.
Yeah, I know. I've danced with every cowboy that came with them. I had to get out of there while I could still walk.
Well, as long as they're dancing, they're not fighting.
Oh? You ever dance with one of them, Matt?
Oh, is it that bad?
Oh. Mr. Dillon? Hello, Miss Kitty.
Evening, Chester.
Mr. Dillon, right across the street there, I just seen Coney Thorne.
What? Well, where was he headed?
He was knocking on the front door of the stage office, and nobody didn't answer, so he went around back.
I'll see you later, kid.
Sure.
Looks like Coney's trying to run off, Mr. Dillon.
There's no stage till tomorrow morning, Chester. This Besides, he doesn't know I'm going to arrest him.
Well, at least he didn't come gunning for you as soon as he got out of bed.
Well, maybe he wants to be sure of a seat on the stage first. You said he went around to the back of the office.
Yes, sir, right up the alley here.
Yeah. Look, you better stay back a little, huh?
Hmm?
Being in bed so long might have made Coney a little nervous.
Well, yes, sir.
Chester!
You all right, Mr. Dillon?
No, he didn't hit me. But I didn't hit him either. He had a horse waiting out there. Come on, if we hurry, we can still follow him.
This is it, L&M filters. This is it, something new.
Now two sizes,
L&M filters, new king size and regular too.
This is it,
L&M filters, L&M filters with the miracle tip.
L&M filters are sweeping the country, breaking more sales records every day.
The reason? It's the filter that counts. And no filter compares with L&M's miracle tip for quality or effectiveness.
And notice how easy it draws. You get much more flavor, much less nicotine. Effective filtration.
Our statement of quality goes unchallenged. L&M is America's highest quality and best filter tip cigarette.
Buy L&M King Size.
Buy L&M Regular.
Buy L&M's by the carton. King Size, Regular, both at the same low price. L&M, light and mild.
With the full moon to help us, Chester and I didn't have much trouble staying on Coney Thorne's trail once we hit it. We pulled up now and then and listened, and we could hear his horse running hard, not too far ahead of us. But he didn't run long. Coney had made a poor choice of the mount that he'd stolen and had sold on him within an hour. We found the horse standing riderless with his head down, his legs weak and quivering.
That poor horse is plumb bedrock, Mr. Dillon. He ought to be shot.
Now, never mind the horse, Chester. Let's find Coney.
He can't be very far. There's no place to hide out here.
There's something over there, Chester. Hmm? Off to the left there.
It ain't moving.
Now, let's take a look. Look, you ride straight from here, and I'll come in on an angle.
Okay, sir.
Chester, but be careful.
Is he dead, Mr. Dillon?
I don't know, Chester, but he's all through shooting. Here, Chester.
Yes, sir.
Bend down here, take a look.
Why, that ain't Coney Thorne.
No. You ever seen this man before?
No, sir, I don't know who it is. He ain't dead.
No, but he's bleeding pretty bad. I'm afraid he soon will be. Who are you, fella? Hey, what's your name?
Marshal.
Yeah, that's right, I'm the marshal. Now, why did you try to shoot me back in Dodge tonight?
You can't do nothing to me now.
No harm in talking.
Heard that fellow was going to shoot you.
Like Coney Thorne?
I don't know his name. I don't know nothing about him.
Well, then what's he got to do with your trying to shoot me?
Nothing.
Only I figured I could do it, and they'd blame him.
Why? I never saw you before. Why did you want to shoot me?
Kill a marshal? That'd be pretty good, wouldn't it? Kill a marshal?
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be pretty good.
Didn't work. You killed me.
He's dead, ain't he?
Yeah, he's dead.
A darn fool. What good would shooting you have done him?
Well, it made him feel better for some reason, Jesse.
But why?
I don't know. That's the idea of shooting a marshal and getting away with it, I guess. He didn't have any more sensible a reason.
No, sir.
Well, let's get him buried. It'll be daylight before we get back to Dodge as it is. I still got to find Coney.
Mr. Dillon is just about to leave. We got back just in time.
Now, why would Coney be taking the stage? He hasn't finished his business here yet.
No, but he was trying to get in the office when I seen him last night.
By heaven, there he is.
Yes, sir, and Abby, too. Now, what are they up to?
Now, let's ask them. Let them stand, Jess.
Yes, sir.
Marshal? You, going someplace, Coney?
Well, I heard about last night, Marshal. But it wasn't me he shot at you. You know it wasn't.
I found the man that did it.
I ain't gonna kill you. That's all over, Marshal.
It is?
It was like being crazy, Marshal. For a long time. And I got the fever, and Abby was there talking to me all the time. Taking care of me. Now, somehow, I ain't mad at nobody.
Well, I'm glad to hear that, Coney.
Being in prison so long when I was innocent, it was bad, Marshal.
Yeah. Yeah. Look, Coney, you shouldn't have left Arizona. You broke your parole. I'm going to have to send you back.
He's going back, Marshal. Right now, with me.
What?
We're going to be married. And then he's going to turn himself in.
Is that true, Coney?
I'll get another year, but Abby says it's the only way.
You're going to get married, huh?
We'll make out, Marshal. But please, please don't arrest him here. Let him go alone with me. It isn't much. You can give him that.
Chester.
Yes, sir?
Go over to the telegraph office and write something out and send it to the Marshal in Phoenix, huh?
Well, what'll I say?
Tell him thanks for the warning. And tell him if Coney Thorne did leave Arizona and came here to shoot me, I'd arrest him quick. But knowing Coney, I think he's learned his lesson. He's got more sense.
Yes, sir.
Now get going. All of you.
Star, William Conrad.
Thank you. If you're a filter tip smoker, you should be smoking L&M's. Everyone agrees L&M's are just what the doctor ordered. The first filter that really does the job and a real good taste to go with it. Maybe you'll prefer L&M's king size as I do. But either size, I know you'll like them and I know you'll stick with them. L&M's. Try them.
Gunsmoke. transcribed under the direction of Norman McDonald, stars William Conrad as Matt Dillon, U.S. Marshal. Tonight's story was specially written for Gunsmoke by John Meston, with music composed and conducted by Rex Corey. Featured in the cast were John Daner, Vivi Janis, and James Nusser. Harley Bear is Chester, Howard McNear is Doc, and Georgia Ellis is Kitty. Join us again next week as Matt Dillon, U.S. Marshal, fights to bring law and order out of the wild violence of the West in Gunsmoke. The makers of L&M Filters also present for your television pleasure the new Stu Irwin Show. It's a happy half hour with June and Stu Irwin, which begins October 20th in most cities. Please check your local television listings for time and channel for L&M's Stu Irwin Show. Hear Gunsmoke every Saturday, this same time, this same station. Hear the great new Perry Como radio show every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, also on CBS Radio.
This is the CBS Radio Network.
Patty cake,
you're a famous man.
Well, all I do is bake them just as good as it can.
What did you seek for Mr. Patty Cake Man?
A sample of them, ladies. One from each pan.
Children's not shoving. There's more in the oven. Hey, Mom!
Put Patty Cake cookies on the shopping list.
Oatmeal, chocolate chip, and sugar mist. I'm seeing varieties on your market shelf.
Why, they're so good, you're lucky I don't eat them all myself.
Patty Cake cookies. Patty cake cookies.
Patty cake cookies, how to satisfy. Blue cellophane package, you can see what's inside.
What makes the taste a good patty cake?
Well, to tell the truth, I sample them, two from each pan.
Really, the only coffee in the world?
Well, your father says so, and your father knows best.
Yes, it's Father Knows Best, transcribed in Hollywood, starring Robert Young as father. A half-hour visit with your neighbors, the Andersons, brought to you by Maxwell House. The coffee that's bought and enjoyed by more people than any other brand of coffee at any price. Maxwell House, always good to the last drop. Slap a bunch of poets together, and at least one thing is bound to emerge: a new definition of love. In one of his flossier moments, Shakespeare wrote, "Love is a smoke raised with the fume of sighs," which is very nice if you go in for that sort of thing. The Messrs. Thurber and White, on the other hand, viewed the emotion with a more practical eye. Love, they said, is the strange bewilderment which overtakes one person on account of another person. In Springfield, in the white frame house on Maple Street, the Andersons probably have ideas of their own on this ethereal subject, like this. I think I'll have a little more rice. Would you mind passing it, Betty?
Yes, Father.
Jim.
Honey, let's not start that business about rice being fattening. It isn't.
Well, you were the one who said that you're wasting...
Margaret, rice is not fattening. It's the stuff you put on it. Like butter. You put butter on anything, it's fattening. But have you ever seen me put butter on my rice?
No, dear.
You're darn right you haven't. Kathy, please pass the gravy.
Here you are, Daddy.
Now that you mention it, what's wrong with my waistline? I haven't gained a pound in 20 years.
What was that?
Well, maybe 2 pounds.
Daddy, look at Bud.
Why, I've been looking at him for 15 years.
He isn't eating his dinner.
Well, maybe he's got problems. Bud? Bud?
Yes, dear.
Dear. Bud, what's the matter with you?
Hmm? Well, Jim, maybe he doesn't feel well.
He's in love.
Kathy, mind your own affairs and eat your dinner.
Well, he is.
Bud, do you feel all right? Bud!
I'll answer.
Sit down.
Don't you want me to answer the phone?
It didn't ring. Will you please sit down?
Something rang. I can still hear it. Kind of like bells. Jim, I think he is ill.
He's in love.
Love.
But if you don't feel well, go to your room. If you do feel well, eat your dinner.
Maybe it's the doorbell.
I didn't hear anything.
But
I just heard it again.
Jim, something is wrong. I don't like the look in his eyes.
You know, for the first time in her life, Kathy may be right. Look at that idiotic grin.
On me?
On your brother. He looks like a cross between Boris Karloff and a contented cow. All right, Bud. Let's stop all this ridiculous moaning and groaning. What's wrong?
Dad.
Yes?
Have you ever been in love?
Why, Bud.
I mean, really in love. With a girl.
Well, your mother wasn't exactly a rhinoceros.
You ought to see her eyes, Dad. They're blue. The bluest eyes you ever saw. Both of them.
Only has two, huh?
And hair. The most beautiful hair. Like the sun shining on my home plate.
But is this a girl or a doubleheader between the Yanks and Cleveland?
It's a girl. The most wonderful girl in the whole world.
Fine. Now eat your dinner.
Food? How can you think of food at a time like this? I don't think I'll ever eat again. Not ever.
I remember when I first met your mother, I went through the same thing. People thought I was going to starve to death.
And did you?
No, I managed to pull through.
Daddy?
Yes, Kathy?
How long didn't you eat?
Oh, I don't know. I don't remember exactly. I know I missed practically one entire lunch.
Jim.
Dad.
What is it, Lochinvar?
Who?
What do you want?
When you and Mom fell in love, what'd you do?
Don't you think you're getting a little nosy?
No, I mean, how did you know you're in love? How often did you see one another?
Oh, a few times a week, something like that.
Jim, you were there every night and you know it.
Margaret, you're being absolutely no help at all. Bud isn't serious about this girl, are you, Bud?
Boy, am I.
I mean, he isn't thinking about marriage or anything ridiculous like that, are you?
What is ridiculous about marriage?
Margaret, he's 15 years old.
Oh, I don't mean for Bud.
Well, we weren't talking about Errol Flynn.
Naturally, Bud isn't going to do anything foolish. Not yet, at any rate.
Of course not. When he gets a little older, that'll be time enough for him to do something foolish.
That's not what I meant, and you know it. Bud is a sensible boy, aren't you, dear?
Sure.
And he knows that he's much too young. He has a lot of time for girls, haven't you, dear?
Boy, have I.
Bud, let's look at this thing in a more practical manner. You know, going out with girls can be kind of expensive. Flowers, candy, movies.
Well, that's one of the things I wanted to talk about, Dad. You see, I only get a dollar and a quarter a week.
Yes?
How can you take a girl out on a dollar and a quarter a week?
You can't.
Well, that's why I was thinking...
But if you're really sincere about this girl, if you think your life and happiness depend on her, well, do what I did. Go sit on her front porch.
Gosh, what kind of fun can you have on a front porch?
Oh, don't be stupid.
Oh,
Bud, when I was courting your mother, all we did was sit on her front porch. Didn't we, honey?
Yes, dear.
Night after night, week after week, we just sat there and held hands.
And looked at the moon. A large, lovely, friendly moon.
Never got so sick and tired of looking at anything in my whole life.
Why, Jim.
Well, let's face it, the same darn thing every night. Just sit there and look at the moon.
There were a great many other boys who were perfectly willing to take your place.
But I wouldn't let them, would I?
You certainly wouldn't. You were the stubbornest thing I've ever known.
Sure, but I was cute. And I knew a good thing when I saw it.
Dad.
Now what?
When you were sure that Mom was the right one for you, I mean, when you knew that you couldn't live without her, then what'd you do?
Well, I... What did we do, Margaret?
Well, you made me get all dressed up in my best bib and tucker, and you took me home to visit your family.
That's right. I can still feel my knees knocking. Was I ever scared?
Not half as scared as I was.
It turned out all right, though, didn't it, honey?
Mm-hmm.
They fell in love with you just like I did. Bud, where are you going?
I'll be right back, Dad. I have to make a phone call.
You come back here and eat your dinner.
Leave the boy alone, Jim. It's his first big love. He's got to get used to it.
Love.
Betty, you haven't said a pleasant word all evening. What's gotten into you?
She isn't eating her dinner either.
Why don't you do your homework?
I did it.
Do it over again.
Can't I just keep still?
All right, but see that you do. Betty, do you feel all right?
I feel fine. She had a fight with Billy Smith.
I thought you were going to keep still.
Well, if I did, nobody'd ever get to know anything around here.
We'd find out, somehow.
Betty, if you and Billy Smith had another argument...
I never want to see him again as long as I live.
I thought you were getting along fine.
We were until he met that Eloise March, that little snip.
Who's Eloise March?
Just the worst little flirt in town, that's all. And if he wants her, he can have her.
Betty, I wouldn't get all upset about it if I were you.
I'm not upset. I'm not the least bit upset. I just wouldn't give you 3 cents for all the men in the world, that's all. I would.
This Eloise March must be quite a character.
She's a vampire, that's what she is.
Is she pretty?
Oh, how do I know? I've never even seen her. I'm through with men. I'm going to have a career instead. I'm going to devote my whole life to being a chemist or something.
I still love you, Betty.
Oh, dear.
Taking it pretty hard, isn't she?
Well, she and Billy have been friends for so long.
What do you think we ought to do?
Mommy.
What is it, dear?
Aren't you glad I don't do anything except break windows?
Yes, dear, you're a great help.
Well, it's all set, Dad. I called her and she's coming over.
Who's coming over?
My girl.
Bud, why in the name of all that's holy?
Well, you said to bring her over, didn't you?
I said no such thing.
But that's what you did. You said so.
Bud, this is not the time to bring a girl around. We're having enough trouble with girls. Your sister and Eloise March and...
How did you know?
How did I know what?
About Eloise March.
What about Eloise March?
That's my girl.
Oh, no. That's wonderful coffee. Welcome words you can hear across your breakfast table from the world's greatest coffee expert. Yes, ma'am, he'll be there, that number one expert, because he's your husband. Naturally, we think we're pretty fair experts. Our Maxwell House coffee is America's favorite brand. But the person with the final say, the one we both want to please, is that husband of yours. And if you'll make his breakfast coffee Maxwell House, we're mighty sure he'll tell you, that's wonderful coffee. Matter of fact, if he doesn't, we'll give you your money back. You see, we know there's no coffee made like Maxwell House. And that's why no coffee tastes like Maxwell House. It's the only coffee with that famous good to the last drop flavor. Get Maxwell House tomorrow and start serving it to your husband. And if he doesn't say it's the best coffee he ever tasted, why, send us the can, an unused portion, and we'll gladly refund the price you paid. Our address is on the front of every one of those familiar blue tins. Tomorrow, find out how much the world's greatest coffee expert enjoys Maxwell House coffee. Always good to the last drop.
These are parlous times in which we live, and days of great decision. Throughout the world, men of substance watch the headlines with an anxious eye, keeping one ear to the ground and the other glued to the radio, which is a neat trick if you can do it. Jim Anderson may not quite succeed, but in the living room of the white frame house on Maple Street, he's giving it quite a try, like this.
Margaret, why don't people leave things where they belong? Margaret!
What is it, Jim?
What happened to my large map of Korea?
I don't know, dear. Where did you put it?
It was right here on the table.
Well, if it was on the table, that's where it ought to be. No one's been in the living room. Jim, what on earth are you doing?
What's the matter?
All those maps on the floor, and Bud's friend is going to be here any moment.
Margaret, I'm waiting for a very important broadcast. It's coming from all over the world. Even Moscow. I don't want to miss a word. This is the only radio in the house that's any good, and you know it.
Oh, right, but I still don't see why you need 8 million maps scattered all over the floor.
There are 5 maps. And where's the one of Korea I had on the table?
Which table?
This table.
What is this?
That's the map.
Of course, you couldn't dream of lifting up a big, heavy magazine.
Well, the magazine had no business being there in the first place.
Dear, if I go into the kitchen, do you think you can find your way back to the radio?
If I get lost, I'll send up smoke signals. One if by land and 2 if by sea.
I'll make a note of it, dear.
Thinks it's so funny. How did I know it was under the magazine? People go around hiding your maps under magazines. Think all a man has to do is go around looking under magazines. Bud!
He's upstairs, Jim.
The doorbell rang.
Bud, the doorbell rang.
I'm combing my hair.
He's combing his hair, Jim.
What do you want me to do about it?
You might answer the door.
Well, if you're going to be logical, wait until a man has something really important to do. Maps all over the floor. All right, keep your shirt on. I'm coming. Dizzy little character. Probably hasn't got a brain in her head anyway. Hello there.
Is this the Anderson residence?
It certainly is. Come on in.
I'm Eloise March, and don't tell me. You're Mr. Anderson.
How did you ever figure that out?
Oh, I'd have known you anywhere, Mr. Anderson. Really, I would. Lover Boy's told me so much about you.
Lover Boy has, hasn't he?
Oh, yes.
That was nice of him. Lover Boy. Bud, your friend is here. The thundering herd will be down in a minute. He's fixing his makeup.
I don't mind.
Well, let's go into the living room and sit down.
All right. My, you have a lovely home. It's so gauche.
I was hoping you'd notice that. We've tried to make it one of the gauchest homes.
And you certainly have.
Yeah. Margaret, Bud's friend is here. Please.
Just a minute, dear.
Mrs. Anderson will be right in. Then you can all go into the den and have a nice little chat.
My, all those great big maps. What are they?
Oh, just maps of the world. I use them for reference on the important news broadcasts.
You do? Why, how clever.
I just listen to the broadcasts. I don't deliver them.
How clever to use maps. and of the whole world. It's just like I told Bud. Men are so...
gauche?
Aren't they ever?
Margaret!
Oh, Buzzy boy!
Hi, Eloise. Gee, you look nice.
Oh, but I don't either. Why, I threw on just any old thing.
You sure threw them in the right place, didn't you?
Yes, he's quite a picture.
Oh, why, Mr. Anderson.
And speaking of pictures, why don't you show Miss Marsh the pictures in the den or someplace?
But you said when you took Mom over to your house...
Let's not have any arguments about it. There's going to be a very important broadcast...
I'm sorry to have kept you waiting, Miss Marsh, but I was busy in the kitchen.
Mom, this is Eloise.
I'd have known you anywhere, Mrs. Anderson. Bud has told me so much about you.
Oh, I'm sure he must have.
Father, was that the phone?
No, it wasn't the phone. It was the doorbell.
I'll be right down.
It wasn't for you. Margaret, why don't you take Bud and Eloise into the den and give them some milk and cookies or something?
Milk and cookies?
Holy cow, Dad.
Mr. Anderson, you're so droll.
Margaret.
Why don't we show Eloise the pictures we took this summer, Bud? I'm sure she'd like that.
But I thought when Dad took you over to his house...
Hi, what's all the excitement about?
Betty, why don't you go back upstairs?
What for? We'll explain all about it later. Go ahead, dear.
Why can't I stay down here?
I know. You must be Kathy.
That's Betty.
Oh, of course, Betty. I'd have known you anywhere. Bud's told me so much about you. I'm Eloise March.
No!
Margaret, why don't you all go into the den?
The nerve of her coming into this house after what she did to me.
What, who did to you?
Bud, why don't you take Eloise
she
into the...
She came here to sneer at me, that's what she did.
Eloise?
I don't know what she's talking about, I swear I don't.
Oh, yes, you do. You know just what I'm talking about.
If you'd all just go into the den...
Now, see here, Betty, you have no right to talk to Eloise that way.
I'll talk to her any way I choose.
You will not.
I certainly will.
Betty, if you'll just go upstairs like a good girl...
Why don't you all go into the den?
Look at her. Powder and paint an inch thick, and Billy Smith thinks she's so wonderful.
Billy Smith?
But, honey, you know I don't care about anybody but you.
You told the same thing to Billy Smith.
I never did.
Bud.
And Janie Liggett's sister said you told the same thing to Russell Spencer.
Eloise, you didn't.
She certainly did.
Betty.
And he was going steady with Marion Swift all the time, and you knew it.
I did not know it.
Bud.
Jim, it won't do any good.
It has to. They're going to start the broadcast any minute. Look, if you'll all just go into the den...
Eloise, how could you?
How could I what?
Say what you said when you said you never said what you said before.
Well, I never did say it before.
You certainly did.
Buzzy, how can you stand there and let her talk like that?
You told me you never went out with older men.
I don't.
Billy Smith's 18, and you went out with him.
Well, only 3 or 4 times, and that doesn't mean anything, does it?
You've only been out with me twice.
Bud, you're standing on my map.
Just because I go out with a boy 3 or 4 times, what does that prove?
Betty!
You went out with Billy Smith, and you told me you didn't go out with Billy Smith.
Not since Tuesday.
Bud, you're walking all over Alaska.
Betty!
Just because he's older than I am and gets a bigger allowance...
He does?
Sure he does. So does everybody else. Why don't you go out with them?
Don't worry, she will. Betty, telephone!
Why don't you all go into the telephone?
I'm going home! That's where I'm going.
Good!
And Bud Anderson, you're just the nastiest boy I've ever known in my whole life.
Bud, why don't you take Miss March to the door?
She just said I was nasty.
He doesn't have to take me to the door. Now or ever.
And that goes for me, too.
If you'll just go into the den.
I'm sorry I ever came into this house, that's what. And I'm sorry I said it was gauche. Because it isn't.
Well.
Holy cow.
right, Betty, answer the phone.
Brazen little snip.
I guess I told her.
Gee whiz. And I spent my whole allowance on a box of candy for her.
If no one has an objection, now may I listen to the broadcast?
A whole dollar and a quarter gone.
Bud, why don't you go into the kitchen and fix yourself a sandwich?
A sandwich? How can you eat with a broken heart?
Easier than with an upper plate. Now stop acting like an idiot and behave yourself.
Women, they're just a curse of humanity.
Yes, dear, we're awful.
Oh, I didn't mean you, Mom.
Margaret, will you take that boy out and drown him? I've got to have quiet in here for the broadcast.
All right, Bud, let's go inside now.
Mother, it was Billy. It was Billy Smith. He explained all about Eloise Marsh.
Betty, please.
He's a psychology major, and he was just using her for research.
Oh, no.
That's fine, dear.
And he's coming over right away with Russell Spencer and Marion Swift.
No.
What?
I've had enough of this circus tonight. This is my house, too. I live here just as much as anybody, and I'm going to listen to this broadcast.
But, Father, I told them.
I don't care what you told them. I'm going to hear the broadcast, and that's final.
Betty, there's no reason why you and your friends can't go down to the playroom.
But we'll have to sneak around on our tiptoes.
Quiet, please.
At 9 o'clock, due to this unforeseen difficulty, the news broadcast originally scheduled for this period will not be heard. In its place, we bring you that heartwarming tale of young love, the romance of Susan Blake.
Oh, no!
At a time like that, I guess there just isn't much for Father to say. But I know one place where he's always got some mighty important words. When it comes to coffee, he can tell you exactly where to get the most in flavor for your money. Sure, Father knows best. He's the world's greatest coffee expert, just like that man of yours. And we think it'll really pay you to get your husband's expert opinion on our Maxwell House coffee. Because when he tries a cup and says, "Best coffee I ever tasted," you'll know Maxwell House gives you the most for your money. The most in flavor, the most in pure pleasure. Get a pound of Maxwell House tomorrow. See how your husband takes to that wonderful good to the last drop flavor. And count all the cups of truly good coffee you get from that 1 pound. We think you'll be convinced your coffee buy is Maxwell House coffee. Because it's always good to the last drop.
It's midnight in Springfield, and all is quiet in the white frame house on Maple Street. That is, all should be nice and quiet. But you know how it is with the Andersons. Noon or midnight, there's never a dull moment like this.
Jim. Jim.
What? What's the matter?
Jim, wake up.
What for?
Listen, I just heard something downstairs.
Oh, go to sleep, Margaret. It's probably nothing but a burglar.
Jim, are you going downstairs, or do you want me to call Bud?
No, never mind. Now go.
Be very careful, dear. Please.
Sure, I'll be careful.
If it is a burglar, just call the police.
That's a very good idea. Thank you very much. Wake a man out of a sound sleep and then expect him to go roaming around in the dark.
Oh, Jim.
One of these nights, I'm going to fall down the stairs and break my neck. Serve him right, too. Call the police. What did she think I was going to do, wrestle with him? All right. Oh.
Hiya, Dad. What's up?
I am. What are you doing down here?
I was hungry. Want a sandwich?
No, thank you. What happened to your broken heart?
Oh, I don't know. I was an awful boob, wasn't I?
No, not exactly. But you're getting there. Now, hurry up and get back to bed. Your mother's worried enough for one night.
Okay. Oh, say, Dad.
Yes?
Did you put a dollar on my dresser?
We'll talk about it tomorrow.
Dad.
Now what?
Thanks for everything.
Go to bed.
You bet. Good night, Dad.
Good night, lover boy.
It's a wonderful feeling to start the day singing. Life is swell when you keep well. That's why Post 40% Bran Flakes have become America's largest selling Bran Flakes. Every 1 ounce serving of Post 40% Bran Flakes provides bran to help prevent irregularity due to lack of bulk in the diet. They're so delicious tasting and so good for you, too. Tomorrow, serve America's favorite Bran Flakes. Post 40% Bran Flakes. Join us again next week when we'll be back with Father Knows Best, starring Robert Young as Jim Anderson, with Roy Bargy and the Maxwell House Orchestra, and yours truly, Bill Foreman. So until next Thursday, good night and good luck from the makers of Maxwell House, America's favorite brand of coffee. Always good to the last drop. Father Knows Best was transcribed in Hollywood and written by Ed James. Now stay tuned in for Dragnet, which follows immediately over most of these stations. Now it's Dragnet. Next Tuesday, laugh with Bob Hope on NBC.